Lord, even though we're outside today, we give God praise and glory. Come on, toot those horns. Let us know you're alive and give God praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We give God praise and honor for all of you that are here in this drive-in worship service today. And we just ask you to come join in with us with songs that lift up the name of Jesus so that the world and the community may be to hear the rejoicing of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Test it.
Praise the Lord, I'm a soldier.
I'm
a soldier. I'm a soldier
in the army of the Lord.
I'm a soldier
in the army.
I'm a soldier
in the army of the Lord.
I'm a soldier
in the army.
I'm a soldier
in the army of the Lord.
I'm a soldier
in the army.
I've got my war clothes on. I've got my war clothes on.
In the army of the Lord.
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army.
If I die, let me die.
In the army of the Lord.
Oh, if I die, let me die.
In the army.
If I die, let me die.
In the army of the Lord.
If I die, let me die.
In the army.
I'm a soldier.
In the army of the Lord.
Got my war clothes on.
In the army of the Lord.
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army.
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army of the Lord.
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army.
If I die, let me die. God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
I know God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
Yes, God is a good God.
Yes, he is.
Oh, God is a holy God.
Yes, he is.
I know God is a holy God.
Yes, he is.
I say God is a holy God.
Yes, he is.
God is a holy God.
Yes, he is.
There's a storm out on the ocean and it's moving this old way. If your soul's not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. There's a storm out on the ocean, and it's moving this away. If your soul's not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. Oh, drift away, Lord, drift away. You will surely drift away. If your soul's not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. How many believe that God deserves?
Amen.
Hallelujah. You deserve it. Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs to you. 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 You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. You deserve it. Come on, help me now. My hallelujah belongs to you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. My hallelujah belongs to you. My hallelujah belongs to you. Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs to you. You deserve it. 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 Your glory belongs to you. All of the glory, all of the glory belongs to you. Oh, all of the glory belongs to you. Hallelujah. All of the glory belongs to you. You deserve.
Turn your Bible to Joshua.
Joshua
chapter 3. And if Reverend Melanie finds it, she's going to read verse 13. Amen. Joshua chapter 3. And she's going to read verse 13. Joshua chapter 3. In verse 13.
And it shall come to pass as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests that bear the ark of the Lord of all the earth shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above, and they shall stand upon an heap. Joshua chapter 3, verse 13. God's word for God's people.
Amen. We want to talk about today, step into your miracle. Hallelujah. God is getting ready to do a work, and I believe that beyond measure. Regardless of what we are going through right now by way of COVID-19, I'm believing that God is getting ready to make the body of Christ even stronger. Amen. God has put us in a place to where not only we could take self-examination or self-assessment of where we stand with him, but I believe that God is getting ready to do even greater work. And I believe that he's getting ready to use his children on a higher plane. Amen. But we have to be ready for what God is getting ready to do. Amen. Whenever a miracle occurs, it is unexplainable. But even when it does happen, there are a lot of people that question whether it's real or not. Amen. But how many of us know that when God performs miracles, it defies and it goes against human logic? Amen. By definition, a miracle is that phenomenal thing for which there's no rational explanation. Amen. God knows how to take the impossible and make it possible. Is that right? A lot of us have heard of or we have witnessed miracles either in our own lives or in the lives of those around us. We tend to praise God for the miracle, but oftentimes we forget that those who acted in faith are the ones that were responsible for claiming the miracle. You remember in the year, I believe it was somewhere around about 2009, you remember when a flock of geese brought down a passenger jet. Amen. And the captain struggling, and he looked, and the only thing he saw below was the Hudson River. Amen. And he testified and he said, Lord, he had to do nothing but pray and ask God for a miracle. He prayed for a miracle, and then he took his plane and headed it straight for the waters of the Hudson River. Everybody ended up was safe on the plane. And to this day now, the Hudson River is called the Miracle on the Hudson. God know how to take something that seems impossible and turn it around and make it possible. This very day that we're in today, there are millions around the world who are seeking and asking God for a miracle. Sometimes the miracle we need faces us, but are we really ready to step into our miracle? Amen. This happened when we find ourselves faced with the choice of a life-saving medical procedure. When the doctor tells us that we only have a 50% chance of success. But it takes a leap of faith, amen, to step into an unknown territory and yet believe that God is able. I don't care how hopeless it may look. If you have faith as the size of a mustard seed, hallelujah, You can speak to the mountain and tell that mountain to be moved hence and watch God move on your behalf. I've learned that God don't need no shedding tears. God is not impressed with how good we sound, and he's not impressed with how much we cry and holler out. God is impressed by activating the faith. Can I get a witness? Hebrews 11 and 6 tells us that without faith, it is impossible to please God. Yes, in order to succeed at these type of ventures, we have to exercise the faith and believe that God is able to take over. We need to trust him that he's taking charge and he's in control. We've seen miracles unfold in front of our eyes. But in order for a miracle to occur in an individual's life, amen, you have to believe enough in order to step into the miracle for it to take place. I wish I had a witness here. As Christians, we have to trust God completely. We can't halfway trust God. Hello, somebody. Yeah, somebody said it's easy to trust God when the sun is shining, but what about when the dark clouds are hanging low? What about when the rain is falling? What about when the thunder is rolling? Can you really trust God? Our text here in the book of Joshua focuses upon Joshua as he's performing an act of faith in order that God would provide a miracle that he had already promised the children of Israel. The children of Israel had wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. And even in the midst of that, they refused to move into the promised land because of fear and for 40 long years, Joshua had urged the people to step forward and claim the promise of God. But they hesitated. They got scared. Hallelujah. But God told Joshua, he said, Joshua, I want you to tell the people to get ready to step into their destiny. It was a promise that God had already given them. And even though the Red Sea was in front of them, that promise looked like it was impractical because the promised land was on the other side of the Jordan River. Amen. And I don't have time to do any geographical teaching, but at most of the times, our promise, the manifestation of it, is on the other side of the Jordan River. Now, the Jordan River represents obstacles. Hello, somebody. Let me tell you something. When God is getting ready to do a work in your life, you better believe will always try to put up Jordan rivers in your path. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? Have God ever promise you something and you've been waiting on it and you've been waiting on it, but every time you look around, does not seem like it's going to manifest? Baby, sometimes you got to cross the Jordan River in order to get to what God has promised you. The old folks used to sing a song. It said, Jordan River, I'm bound to cross. Hallelujah. I got one more river to cross. Hallelujah. Sometimes you got to get beyond the river in order to enjoy the promise that God has already given us. But let me tell you something about this Jordan River. Most of the time, this river was shallow. And normally, it would be no problem crossing this river. But if you look in verse 15 of this same chapter, verse 15 indicates that this was a time of year that the river normally overflowed its banks. In other words, the snow on the mountains would normally melt around about this time. And when the snow melted, then everything else would flow down the mountain and all of the small rivers that flowed into the Jordan caused the Jordan to swell. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, sometimes the Jordan River looks bigger than what it actually is. Amen. I come to give someone some hope today. Amen. Because you might be at your Jordan River right now. Maybe you're standing at your Jordan River right now. But I want to encourage you today to let you know that it's not as big as it looks. Now, it all depends on how you're looking at it. It all depends on what perspective are you looking at it from. Hello, somebody. Because if you have enough faith as the size of a grain of mustard seed, then that Jordan River, even though it may swell, but God is still able. Tell somebody, God's still able. This river that was usually less than a half of a football field had grown three times, and it was too deep for anybody just to wade through on feet. But in order to get to the promised land on the other side, it would take a miracle for a million people to cross over the Jordan. Just think about it. A million people trying to cross a river in its flooding stage. God told Joshua, he said, Joshua, I want you to get the priests, and I want you to have them to bring the Ark of the Covenant out to the front. And when the priest step one foot into the water, I want you to see what God is able to do. He will cause the river to separate, and he'll prepare a dry path for the people to cross. Good God Almighty. This is not the first time that God actually performed a miracle with crossing a river or a sea. You remember when the children was coming out of Egypt and they got down there to the Red Sea. Hallelujah. Mountains on both sides. Red Sea in front of them. Pharaoh hot on their tracks behind them. God told Moses, said, Moses, what is that you got in your hand? Moses said, all I got is a rod. He said, stretch out the rod. Cross the Red Sea. And the record said that when Moses crossed that rod out over the sea, the waters parted. Walls of water were built up on each side. And the children of Israel walked across on the dry land. Hallelujah. God told Moses, said, Moses, you just stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. However, became specific when it came to Joshua. He told Joshua exactly what he wanted him to do. He said, Joshua, no matter how much it may seem impossible, nothing will happen unless you call on the priest first. Get the priest to bring the Ark of the Covenant and let them march first and step into the Jordan. And Joshua obeyed. The Bible said that the swelled up in a heap, and they drained into the Dead Sea. Miracle occurred. If you look at verse 17 said they were not bogged down in mud, but dry. Is a high swell, the Jordan is able to provide you with dry ground. Can I get a witness? Yeah, when they got on the other side, the people were left there with a great witness and testimony. What obstacle can stand in the way of a mighty God who's able to open doors that no man can shut? A God who's able to close doors that no man could open. God is all powerful, and he can fulfill every promise that he makes. However, Israel didn't make it to the promised land until they actually stepped into their miracle. My brothers and sisters, I want to share something with you about miracles. And this is something that I found that is definitely true. A lot of times when we act in doubt and fear, our miracle tends to gather dust. For 40 years, the miracle that Israel needed was right there in front of them. But the miracle gathered dust because they wandered around in the wilderness for 40 long years. Hallelujah. The miracle was already there. All they had to do is just step into it. Amen. But you know what the good thing is about it? That even in the midst of their doubt, even in the midst of their fear, even in the midst of their skepticism, they waited until they finally was ready to step into the miracle. A lot of times we think that God unjust and to where if I don't do this, God gonna scratch me out. How many of you serve God? How many of you know that He's able to look beyond all of our faults? He's able to pick us up when we fall. If we sin. For 40 years, wandering around in the wilderness, and their miracle gathered dust. For a lot of modern Christians, our personal miracles may be gathering dust as well. All because maybe we're fearful, maybe we are doubters, maybe we just don't see how it's going to happen. But my brothers and sisters, we need to be ready to make that first step. And this is what I want to talk about today. What does it take in order for us to step into our miracle? Number one, trust God. Hallelujah. I don't care how it might look. We just got to trust God. Joshua, and when God gave him instructions, and without hesitation, he moved. God told him to move. In spite of look, when God moved, he moved. My brothers and sisters, in order to step into our miracle, we will trust God. God say move, then we need to be about God and go on God's word. I wish I had a prayer church today. We have to believe in the miracle power of God. It's one of those strong foundations of our faith. With all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our soul, learn to take God at His word. To trust God means that we have to just put the total situation in His hands. Psalm 31 and 1 says, in thee, Lord, do I put my trust. Hallelujah. I'm not trusting in the government. I'm not trusting in man. I'm not trusting in stimulus packages. My total trust is in the almighty hands of God. Hallelujah. That means that I can depend on God. Because guess what? That $1,200 gonna run out after a while. Good God Almighty. That means that I totally rely on God. It means that we put our confidence in whatever we find ourselves in. That God is able to protect us. He's able to guide us. He's able to guide us into a perfect will. Yes, in every situation. Best we can. And then after that, we need to trust God that He's able. That was the about this grandfather His grandfather has spent much of his life teaching his two words. He told him, he said, look, whatever it is you find yourself in, whether you're in school, whether you're on the playground, let God. In other words, he let God work it out. And one of his grandchildren formed the letters, let God. He set the letters that he had made out of blocks on top of the grandfather's fireplace mantle. And he was proud of his blocks. And the grandfather just kept those blocks right there on his mantle. And it would read the blocks that spelled out, let God. So one day, the grandfather lost his wife. And it was a very tragic blow to him. And after the death of his wife, he was hurt and he was all alone. He wouldn't talk to nobody, not even his grandchildren. He just couldn't shake the idea that his wife had been gone. But one day, his great-grandchildren went to see him and they tried to cheer him up and pointed to the words on the block. And when he turned around and he noticed that the D had fallen off the end of God. And when the grandfather turned around, he saw the words, not let God, but he saw the word let go. Hello? Yeah. And sometimes, my brothers and sisters, trusting God means that we got to step forward and let go. Sometimes, a lot of times we don't get ahead or we cannot be successful because we are holding on to stuff that's causing stuff not to happen in our lives. My brothers and sisters, not only would you have to let God, but you got to let go some stuff. Let me say this, and then I'm almost finished. My brothers and sisters, when it comes to miracles, watch this. Little miracles happen every day. Amen. A lot of times when people think about miracles, they think about something extraordinary, something big, and something gigantic. But guess what? Little miracles happen every day. History focuses on big miracles, but all so easy for us, the small miracles. Yeah, when the waters rolled back for Moses at the Red Sea and Joshua at the Jordan River, those were big miracles. But my brothers and sisters, little small instances, people crossed on dry land. Amen. Think about it. When the Jordan River, you would think, after it rained, and then the rain stopped, you look out there, you don't see nothing mud out there. Huh? The Bible said that they walked across in mud. The Bible said dry land. Let me tell you something. God can do things that do not seem logical. Amen. And it defies nature. A lot of times we have to go beyond our natural. God is able. Miracle that God has life. We survive troubling times. We overcame unforeseen odds in order to become victorious. But my brothers and sisters, what about, didn't God wake you up this morning? Hallelujah. A lot of people say, well, you know, I was sick, down on my sick bed, and God raised me up.
But let me tell you something, even if you've never been sick before, even if you never had to spend a night in a hospital before, don't you know that God is still able to perform the little small miracles? When you look around and see folk living up under the bridges, don't know where that next piece of bread coming from. Good God Almighty, when I woke up this morning, I had a piece of bread this morning. That's a miracle. And so, as I quickly hurry along, God know how to take little things and make them go farther than we can ever imagine. You remember the prophet Elijah? Elijah visited the home of a widow woman. And this widow woman only had a little food. And she was just getting ready to prepare her final meal. She told the man of God, she said, well, I only got enough in order to prepare for me and my child to eat, and then we're going to die. But then the man of God came and reminded her of the miracle working power of God. He reminded her that even with a little faith in God, God is able to miraculously put resources at his disposal. According to the record, her small ran dry. My brothers and sisters, God knows. But when your money get funny, somehow God allows you to appear on your table every day. Can I get a witness? Things, and God know how to take the. Yes. God took fat back and took pork bellies and took turnip bottom and took some chitlins and turned the meal into a soul food gourmet. God and turn it around and make it a whole lot. I encourage somebody today and tell you that it's going to take faith in order for you to step into your miracle. Yes, sometimes you have to step into the Jordan River when it's at its flooding stage. Yes, sometimes you have to step in when the water is over your head. Sometimes you got to step in when it don't even seem like it's gonna manifest. You still got to make that step because of I've learned that God honors faith. Can I get a witness? Hebrews 11 and 29 says that by faith, they passed through the Red Sea just like they were walking on dry land. Yes, it takes faith, my brothers and sisters, that no matter how scary it might look, the same God who rolled back the waters, he's able to make you cross over on dry land. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I come to let you know that if you know God in the pardon of your sin, you should not be overly frustrated over the depth of the river, because you already know that God is able. Good God Almighty, he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask. Those around Joshua, Joshua camped in front of the Jordan for 3 long days. He wasn't hesitant out of fear, but he waited to hear God's command. And everybody around him was looking at the rivers getting higher and higher every day. But Joshua still waited on God. Can I get a witness here? I come to let somebody know that you ought not be dismayed at the verge of giving up, because God is able to take your faith and turn it around and make it hopeful. I'm going to my seat now, but I want to encourage you today, be not dismayed. You lack the vision that it takes to see your way clear, because when you are dismayed, then you lack the hope that it takes to believe that no matter how bad it gets, the Lord will make a way somehow. somehow. You ought not be dismayed, because when you're dismayed, your smiling face is turned upside down to a frown. But I heard the Lord say, be not dismayed, whatever betides you, but I, the all-powerful God, I'm able to round the earth in the palm of my hand. I'm able to spangle the night with the moon and the stars. I'm able to bat my eyes and make the lightning flash. I'm able to clap my hand and make the thunder roll. I heard the Lord say, I am thy God. I shall strengthen you when you get weak along the way. But if you look in verse 5 of our text today, Joshua told the people, said, look at here, sanctify yourself. In other words, you got to get ready for what God is getting ready to do. He said, sanctify yourself, for tomorrow God is going to do wonders for his people. Come by to remind somebody, get ready to step into your miracle. There's going to be some dark days, but you ought to be ready to step into your miracle. The wind might blow, but be not dismayed. The burden may seem too heavy, but be not dismayed. Whatever betides you, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you. And I'm so glad that he didn't just start taking care of me just on yesterday, but a long time ago he started taking care of me when he looked down and saw little old me. He said, good God Almighty, I believe I'll go down and I'll redeem. He saw me just as I was. So glad he died. I don't care. I'm so glad that he died. He died. Good God Almighty, to the moon, dripped away in blood. He died. Did he die? I'm so glad he died for my sins. And somebody said, good God Almighty, when they buried him in Joseph's new tomb, it looked like all was lost. Looked like there was no hope. The world was in need of a miracle. Good God Almighty, they waited on God. But somebody said, in the midst, after 400 years, not hearing a word from the Lord, somebody said, behold, there's somebody out there in the wilderness preaching, yeah, telling the world, repent of your sins, for the God is on the way. The record said that early Sunday morning, yeah, the grave couldn't hold him no longer. Death had to take a back seat. Good God of mine, I heard Jesus tell you to move out. You got to put everything down and make that move. If God tell you to go to the right, you better get about the left and start moving to the right. Because God will not lead you to any place where he will through. Yeah, I don't know about you. If he leads you to the Jordan River, he's going to give you what you need in order to go cross the river. Yeah, I don't know about you, but I tried the Lord for myself. I'm finna go sit down now, but I just come to see you. I haven't seen you in a couple of months, but it looks like to me that God been blessing you.
Good God Almighty, it looks like to me nobody missed a meal. Look like to me you're still standing. Look like to me God is still working miracles. I don't know about you, but I decided to put my all trust in an almighty God. And I would not serve any other God. Hallelujah. Get ready to step into your miracle. Your miracle is waiting on you.